Welcome back to another episode of Cigars and Cinema. Grab a cigar, something to pair it with, and let's journey into another episode of Smoke and Screen.
I can go slow ahead. Come on down and chump some of this.
You're gonna need a bigger boat. All the gin joints in all the towns in all the world. She walks in the line.
Is that victory dance? Not until the fat lady sings.
The force is with you, young Skywalker.
I make it big, big, and give them 10% off. I make it 5%. Get out of here!
Today's episode of Cigars and Cinema is coming to you from the OGT Cigar Society. Enjoy a 5-pack of premium custom cigars each month at an undeniable price. Join the community and smoke with us on the Oakland Tobacconist YouTube channel as we delve into the rich experience of boutique and craft cigars and many cigars and vitolas custom made just for our membership. If you're interested and if you want to find out more about the subscription and a whole host of boutique cigars, visit us at www.oaklandtobacconist.com or find us on social media platforms like Instagram and TikTok at OGT Cigars. Hello and welcome to Cigars and Cinema Podcast, where we smoke cigars while unabashedly commentating and in some cases giving extreme opinions on film and entertainment. I'm one of your hosts, Eric Drazen, and as usual, with me tonight is the other co-host, my good friend, Mike Coleman. Coleman, how are you today on this Wednesday?
Doing okay. It's been a little bit of an interesting day, to say the least. But yes. You know, it's always nice to come back to the podcast because it's like just get to smoke a good cigar, talk about movies. This is what I need right now.
Yes. Yes. It's therapy. It's midway through therapy.
Hey, you know what? If it works, it works.
Exactly. Anyone watching this live, we have a few announcements to get to, as well as a movie and a cigar to get to. First off, I will say, if you're smoking with us, please drop down in the comments what you're enjoying tonight. I would love to pull that. And of course, we'll highlight some of that, as well as I want to make this podcast a little more interactive. And that being like, if you have comments on the movie or the cigar we're trying, or when we rate certain things, like, please drop it down and I will pull it up, because this is more of like a hangout for everybody, not just Coleman and I. So there's that aspect. So we got a few people here and I will pull these comments as well. But I also want to make the announcement for anyone who listens to the podcast or anyone who watches the live video. We're going to be changing Cigars and Cinema a little bit. Coleman and I have talked about this and we want to make it more of an idea for... Yeah, just a smidge for us to be able to like smoke with you guys, as well as have a bit more community involved. So going forward next week, we are going to be doing Cigars and Cinema at 7:30 this time, which, I mean, depending on where you're around the world, if you're Eastern Standard, you're 10:30. But what we're going to be doing is we're going to be doing it on Tuesday evenings at 7:30. So Cigars and Cinema will be live every Tuesday, 7:30, as well as it will be ready to be listened to in the coming days of the week. And Coleman, what are your thoughts on the whole, like, you know, live show and stuff? I know that we talked a little bit and kind of like the reasoning behind it. Just hear your thoughts. Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, no. It's one of those things where I feel like at the start of this podcast, it was like, let's talk about cigars. Let's talk about movies. It's something we've always done. Mm-hmm. But it's only so much fun when it's just two people, you know.
Sure.
I feel like we've had multiple of those episodes where we're both like, yeah, this was a great movie, but we're both like, this was a bad movie. It's like,
yes.
So you
yes.
can talk about things, but then I don't know, every, you know, it's two or three times we've had live shows or comments come up while we're talking about it. It generates so much more, you know.
Yes.
It just helps to have more people. It just reinforces the whole point of this is it's where conversations light up. Like, we want to talk about things while smoking good cigars, and it's better when more people are part of the conversation.
Right. So let's see here. We have a few people in. Manuel Lopez, thank you for watching. Texas Torres, first time watching, thank you for jumping on. So yeah. I'm glad you're up here.
Good to have you, man.
Jason, as usual, good to see you, Jason. What's up, Eric Coleman?
Smoking. How's it going, Jason?
Yes.
Okay.
We also have... Nice. La Ashby. So thank you guys for joining on. This should be great. And of course, we have Curtis Bailey. Tonight I'm smoking a poison dart paired with a bullet 10. So good. We got a good audience. Nice. And honestly, I might lean a little bit heavier on Coleman's help tonight in terms of the movie. Because You have more like of a freshly watched eye on what we're talking about. One comment before we jump completely into it. Manuel saying, don't forget everyone, tomorrow is a big live. Yes, sir. IG live. It's actually what I'm smoking tonight. Colm and I are going to be smoking two different things. I thought it would be fun.
We're really changing it up tonight.
Yes. So, as usual, grab a cigar, perhaps something to pair it with, and let's embark on another journey into smoke and screen. Coleman, how about we talk about what you are lighting up tonight?
I am, like, I just tried to lean out of the screen. I did not lean out of the screen. That was amazing. I am smoking this lovely cigar right here.
Crook of the Crown, Stolen Throne, like, burr, 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 like that is a total banger.
Oh, yeah.
For sure.
I'm
love that cigar.
I'm excited for this one.
Yes. And so Coleman's lighting that up, which...
Yeah, what are you smoking, Eric? I'm sorry. I should have asked you. What are you smoking? You're smoking something different. What are you smoking?
Actually, alluding to the live tomorrow, I am smoking this. This is our Stallone OGT Cigars 4th year anniversario. This cigar is something very special to me. It also well represents a lot of what's inside our humidor. We're a boutique-heavy humidor, so Stallone is one of those brands I absolutely love. They put out bangers all the time. And so this is a blend in particular that has been aged for over a year. San Andreas Maduro, double binder from Condega and Jalapa, and fillers primarily of Lajero filler from Condega, Jalapa, and Esteli, Nicaragua. This cigar, Tony Barrios blended for the members, actually for our entire shop, and we're commemorating 4 years. So I'm going to be lighting that up tonight.
Nice.
Yeah, so we got two Maduros going on. Yeah, thank you. And
am I allowed to light up right now? Are we doing the light up sequence?
I think we should go into a cold draw.
I didn't toast the end of it. It's gonna be very cold. Oops, got a little ahead of myself. I'm sorry.
It's time to smoke a cigar.
It is. Yeah. So let's do a cold draw.
So on this anniversario, I'm getting like. There's like an earth texture to it, but there's also like a, I don't know if you've ever like, have you ever like smelled like when you open Ghirardelli, like dark, dark chocolate and it's kind of like bitter, but it's not like kind of sweet. Yeah. I kind of get that with like a musty element going on. So.
Okay.
Draw is perfect.
Yeah. The draw on this is very nice on this one.
Yes. What are you getting so far?
I'm kidding that I lit up the end of it.
That's all right. We're jumping.
I missed the cold draw, guys. I am so sorry. I screwed it up. I'm like, I'm smelling smoke.
There we go. So your blend, interesting history with Crook of the Crown. Yeah. So that is a San Andreas Maduro, just like this one. Company Stolen Throne Cigars launched their entire brand off of that one blend, two different sizes. You have the Toro. 6x52, and there's a Robusto. And the blender and owner, Lee Marsh, was like, you know, it was kind of a scary time to like launch a brand off of one blend. And I had to make 100,000 cigars. And I was like, hopefully I sell this within a year. And hopefully I'm not going to be smoking 100,000 cigars because I enjoy the cigar. But I guess I'll be doing that if it doesn't sell. Lo and behold, they sold out in 3 months. Like it was like, so...
Wow.
Yeah, the exact opposite problem. I had to like continue to order. And now Stone Throne's got 4 different lines. It's like a big, like major brand here at the shop. So if you guys haven't tried Stone Throne, check it out. It's really good.
Yeah. Really good. That's cool.
Yeah. But with that said, yeah, by all means, let's light up our cigar and get into our movie. Yes. Every cigar is smoked in thirds. First third, second, and final. Just as every movie in 3 acts. As you light up, take the time to toast it, smell the room note, and experience the first notes as the tobacco comes alive. In the same way, movies follow a structure, the Aristotle structure, inciting incident, attack, crisis, climax, resolution. In this order, we will break down the cigar and we will break down the movie. All right.
Ooh.
Burst of flavor right up front, and I know it's going to be different because we're smoking two different things.
I know I don't have. You're not going to be my crutch right now.
You're going to have to name 7 different flavor profiles, all in alphabetical and chronological order at the same time.
That's what I'm terrified of. I have a surprise pop quiz.
Well, so here, we'll do this. I'll get into the flavor notes of mine so far, and then I would like to know what you think about Crook. So right off the bat, there's like a saltiness on the lips. There's a gentle spice. If you retro, you'll bring that like black pepper forward, at least for me. Espresso is one of the dominant notes in this cigar. I mean, this is definitely not the first one I've smoked. In fact, I probably have smoked too many. But like espresso and like coffee elements are playing around. And I would also say like a fair amount of like leather is going on as well. So great startup. And every single one, like draw, is a big thing for me. I've been enjoying the draw for sure.
Yeah. Mine is... Mine has a very strong, I'm going to say the buzzword, has a strong mineral taste.
Uh-oh.
There is a
mineral.
No,
mineral
no. Taste. Not bad, though. Not bad, though. It's hard to explain, but there's almost like a weight in the mineral taste.
Okay.
And the ones that I don't like, they're like, they almost feel heavy, like in your nose. They're just like heavy. This one isn't. Like, it's actually much more of like a bright flavor. Not okay. Like heavy, like almost like okay. Almost like an oil laden flavor versus like not.
Okay,
that makes sense. Yeah. I don't know. It's hard to
totally.
I
don't know. Yeah, so I'm watching some of the comments too here in terms of our flavor notes are picking out. Manuel Lopez saying coffee and pepper are my favorite notes. Mine too. Mm-hmm. I'm probably a sucker for them. I mean, I know that Coleman's like you have a lot of Nicaraguan cigars on the channel, which is true. So I apologize. That's most
he does.
Of. The channel's a little biased to my palate, probably.
I mean, it's your channel. Well, shouldn't it be?
But I will definitely say it's things that I definitely enjoy. I also see that Lul Ashby is also saying from Cigars Daily, which is awesome. You're in Tim's neck of the woods, being from Arizona.
I am. Sadly, yeah. He's much more north than I am. Mm. He's like North Phoenix.
Okay. So yeah, so this is the beginning third. Not a bad
meaning if he was closer, I would go a lot right. More often.
Right. Right. It's a you know a distance thing for sure. I mean you could go to Oakland Tobacconist. We're only a state away.
I was gonna say that's only a 6-hour drive.
But why don't you tell us, Coleman, what are we talking about? What is the topic of conversation when it comes to the movie this evening?
The movie this evening. We're doing Across the Spidervrse. So we're a little late to the game, but I figure it's a good one to talk about. It's one that I recently watched because I unfortunately missed it during its theater run. Mm. I mean, or is it still in the theater?
Nah, in some theaters it is, actually. Yeah.
Really?
Okay. Still lasting.
So, because I was going to say, when I went to go see Oppenheimer, there was still like one screen showing that had like the two times. It was like 3:10 and, you know, 5:50 or whatever. But it was like, oh, those are the kids' hours. But but yeah, anyways. So I was wondering if it was still out, but I was able to purchase it. So I was able to stream it and watch it. And it was like, hey, let's talk about this. This is a great movie.
Yeah.
So we're going to do Across the Spider-Verse.
Sweet. Now, so hopefully anyone
you guys
watching,
all like your superhero movies.
Yeah, exactly. Now, anyone watching, please drop down in the comments. I see Texas Taurus is saying, I watched it Monday. Not bad. So,
not bad. Okay.
There's a vote for not bad. If you guys have seen it, please drop in the comments. What were your thoughts on Across the Spider-Verse? Now, we talked about Into the Spider-Verse, I think, I don't know, 4 episodes, 5 episodes ago. Kind of on like the cusp. I think like the day after we did it was launch date for Across the Spider-Verse. So kind of let it time marinate a little bit. Before we get into facts, you, when we talked about this on the phone, you had a hot take on it. What is that hot take?
I it shouldn't be a hot take, but I think this movie's phrased it that way. Better than the first. Well, I'm just saying, I think this movie's better than the first. It's like, I need to watch it at least 2 more times, just having the right mindset, being ready for it to like really, really take it in. But on first watch through, I was just like, they did it. They made a better one than the first one. Like, I was truly afraid when they announced a second one was coming out. Like, that is such a perfect little package. You're not gonna top it, you know. Okay. And they didn't try to. Like, that's the biggest reason why I take this hot take, is they didn't try and beat the first one. They really did just push all the characters forward, and it's like amazing. Like, I think it's better than the first one. So,
okay, there you go. There we go. Yeah, we got Curtis saying, I saw this movie in the theater and had mixed feelings. It does a lot of great things, but doesn't match the highs of the original. Bom, bom, bom.
You don't think so? No, that's okay. It's true. The highs of the original, because I saw the original in theaters, and geez, yeah. The movie is amazing. I feel like I said that on the last podcast, that it's like, it's an amazing, phenomenal movie. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not hard to say that what they're doing with this Spidervrse, the, you know, the cartoon ones, is like, and this is the hard part, is normally I defer to you on comics and ask, like, hey, what's like, what is this accurate to the origins or whatever? Because you've read a lot more of comics than I have. But I don't think, have you read any of the Miles Morales line of Spider-Man?
Actually, I haven't read that. Kind of came like right after when I was like into it.
Right, when we were starting to get out of it. So, and that's how I feel, is when they announced, you know, Miles Morales or, you know, into the Spider-Verse, I was like, who's this? You know, and people are like, it's like an established Spider-Man comic. And I'm like, oh, I didn't know. Like, sorry. So it's one of those where I feel like I had kind of gotten out of my comic book shop phase, going there on the weekends. But anyways, moving on.
Yeah, well, and actually Curtis wants to add to his take is there's nothing that surpasses the "what's up, danger" scene from the first.
I 100% agree. I do not disagree with you at all, Curtis. There, that whole montage of "what's up, danger" is like in a league of its own. It's one of those moments, just, I don't know, pick a handful of classic movies throughout time where you can pull segments of the movie and just kind of set it there on the shelf. And it's like, the movie is like, I mean, one of the most iconic ones, you know, it's like, I want the truth. It's like, you can't handle the truth. It's like, how many people, when you talk to them about A Few Good Men, and they're like, what did you think of A Few Good Men? And they're like, I mean, it was good. You know, I mean, the court scene was really cool, you know, but it's like, they don't care about the whole movie. They don't, you know, it's like, it's just that scene is always the iconic scene. That is what's up, danger. Like, it's on that level of just take it out, set it on a mantle. Like, this is an achievement for filmmaking in general, but like, you could remove it from the whole movie and it's just, it's on its own. So movie as a whole is still really good, but that scene, the very long way of saying what I'm trying to say is I don't use that scene in my metric of comparison, because nothing else would ever win. Like, so I don't feel like it's objectively fair to say, like, oh, you know, this one batter hit a grand slam, all of a sudden the team is, you know, great. It's like, well, the batter's great. The team still needs some work, you know, like it's that type of thing.
Yeah, I can see that analogy for sure. So let's get into a few facts. Across the Spider-Verse was released this year in 2023. There's a runtime of 2 hours and 20 minutes. Directors, last names I'm going to name because there's three different directors, is Santos, Powers, and Thompson. And it stars a lot of the same stars from the first one, like Moore and Steinfeld and Jake Johnson. And Jason Schwartzman, but I will also say it has a few favorites added, such as Oscar Isaac. Like, Oscar Isaac, premium, like, huge fan.
He's amazing. He is in the, like, he's in the peak of his career. He's just, I'm still waiting for the movie where he's going to start kind of downfalling, but he's like, he's just kind of riding that high. Like, he's doing great right now.
No, he is. He's a great actor. Normally it's like, oh, if he's in a movie, then I'll definitely give it a try. And so as a quick synopsis, you got Miles Morales catapults across the multiverse where he encounters a team of spider people charged with protecting its very existence. When the heroes clash on how to handle a new threat, Miles must redefine what it means to be a hero. So I think this is always the big question. When you're dealing with sequels, when you're dealing with number three of the trilogy, Son of Something, Return of Something, I feel like the natural tendency is always like, okay, so how do we make this bigger and better than the last one? So he's got to be bigger and better. And while that can work, you also have the formula of like, it just becomes the same problem just on a bigger scale. And therefore it doesn't seem as original. I felt like this one was like, you have the first one, which was so maybe unexpected is the word I'm looking for. It was very unexpected of how charming it was, how visually stunning it was.
No one was prepared. Like, no one knew what they were walking into.
Right. And when you have a film that's that directed, like, it knows its journey and where it's going, I feel like there are so many things you can ask, like, well, what about this? I wonder what this would look like. And it's like, well, we have that saved for our next story because our next story has a purpose. It's not just we need to hit the box office running. We need to make sure we get out in front. We need to learn the ways of water. I'm not dropping any hints. But they need to, like, basically have a direction. I felt like this movie was a bit more, I guess, like even more directional, possibly. And that's not to say the first one wasn't, but this one just like visually is the first thing I think about this movie. Like visually, it's when it comes to the multiverse,
it's amazing. Side. Oh yeah, no, 100%. Yeah, no. Go ahead, please.
Well, I think that it was a very smart move, setting everything up on Gwen Stacy's world. I really like the intro of like creating the problem, creating the issue, because the like takeaway from the beginning opening scene is really the conflict between Gwen and her dad to me, versus like, oh, there's heroes and they're being sent across the universe and multiverse and now there's a problem. I even like how they take a jab. It's kind of a jab. But like when Spider-Man 2099 first shows up and he's like, don't even get me started with that nerd and Doctor Strange and whole multiverse thing. So it was very well, like, I don't know, directed and digestible and such like that. So
it was also just well balanced in how serious it took itself, but also the ridiculousness of what they're like presenting, you know.
Right.
We're saying these are all multiverse things, like different universes that are existing. We're combining all these things. We know it's absolutely ridiculous, but we're going to like be self-aware enough that we know it's ridiculous. So we're going to make fun of the other Spider-Man that's doing the same thing. You know, like it's a charm, you know?
Right.
And they sometimes people way overdo it, you know, on the breaking the fourth wall. And then other people, it's like, it's the little sprinkle at the end, the little sprinkling of the, because it's like, ah, yes, perfect. Thank you. Like, you're not taking yourself too seriously and you're respecting me as a watcher, you know, or as a, you know, whatever you want to call yourself, moviegoer.
And like, as the beginning opens, of course, like, I like how Gwen Stacy's doing the whole drum punk rock thing and kind of like giving the backstory of, let's do this one more time. Let's set this up and this is where I'm at. And I feel like the major dramatic question is asked within that first sequence of events of like, so you have different people in the multiverse and they're in places they don't belong. And so you need to reset that without resetting and destroying the canon that is the Spider-Man story. But in that is the major dramatic question is, even in your own multiverse, your own verse dimension that you're from, the main protagonists are dealing with that question. Do I belong here? Do I?
Yeah.
Is this where I am? And like when she's confronted with her dad and she's like, I don't know how to fix this. She leaves and like apparently gone for 3 months and is doing this whole off this other thing. It's like, but she's trying to find a place where she belongs and it's just not happening there for her. So would you say that's what you find in terms of major dramatic question of the movie or thoughts on that? What do you think?
I would agree that yes, that's probably the major dramatic question just because really quick. Well, I'm going to bookmark major dramatic question real quick and just kind of, I want to set a real quick foundation with protagonist first before we go into major dramatic question.
Okay.
Do you feel like this is protagonist Miles Morales, or do you feel like this is now a dual protagonist in Gwen and Miles?
This is probably a gamble.
This isn't a trick question.
My heart tells me. I kind of feel like we're dealing with a multi-protagonist plot.
That's immediately where my mind went watching this movie, seeing as how the entire introduction of the movie is her. And I just, I feel like they did this on purpose. They literally like mention Miles at the beginning, showing this is how we know this character. But we're literally giving her an introduction to like her whole own movie. And then we're going to restart the movie again where you think it's supposed to start. Okay. And then so it makes sense when she comes in. We know she has her whole own movie going on. Okay. And now our two movies connect, and now we're watching the dual protagonist movie. That's so now, how I just kind of want to make sure that we agree on that first.
Sure.
Like, do we agree on that?
Yes. No, yeah, that's where my mind goes. Okay. The question is now posed to everyone watching. Thoughts. Do you feel like we're dealing with only Miles Morales as the protagonist of this film? Do you think that Gwen Stacy and them are both? What are your thoughts on that? Now, I have like an inkling of why I would support multi-protagonist plot. But again, like I said, I'm going to have to rely on you a little bit because it's been some time since I've watched this film in its entirety because I saw it in theater and I haven't been able to like completely sit down and give it a full amount. But anyone watching, I would love to hear your thoughts on that. But I feel like you have that major dramatic question opening with her.
Right.
And then you have, okay, the parallel dimension, dealing with Miles in the same exact issue as dealing with his parents and all those problems. And then they
Not the same.
Similar. Not the same in what way?
What do you mean? Because I feel like that's a very important part at the end of the movie. But we'll get there. They're dealing with similar problems, but not the same. But they are dealing with the kind of traditional Spider-Man, I'm alone, I don't have anyone I can confide in. Like that's how and the whole, you know, dealing with someone finding out who you are that you love and then seeing the very different reactions. Because note the different reaction between Prowler and her dad, you know. Because that, like I said, I feel like that comes up later in the movie as well. Like, just why the familial reactions are different. But really quick, but going back to the bookmark really quick. So for your major dramatic question, just recap real quick. You think the major dramatic question is?
Where you belong. Mm-hmm. Do you fight for where you believe you belong? And basically where is home for you, and will someone who's tackling this the problem of being a Spider-Man, Spider-Woman, Spider-Gwen, will they find that acceptance and that home for who they actually are? And that means confiding in those people. So when I say they're dealing with the same problem, I mean like that's the through line. They have to, if they're both dual protagonists, they're dealing with that foundational similarity. It comes out in different ways. Yes, yes. Curtis is dropping down a comment here saying, I agree on dual protagonists. In the first, Gwen was a mostly supporting character, but in this one, much more of the film's emotional weight in Gwen's story.
Exactly. No, and that's, and I would 100% agree with that, is that Gwen was a supporting character in the first one. She was part of it. But I feel like that's why they gave her the intro to the movie first.
Yes.
Because they basically say like, hey, we're going to have like 1.5 movies, and the half movie we're going to put at the start. So you kind of know that movie. So then when we start the rest of the main movie, it all kind of ties in and makes sense. And she has a lot more, you know, weight. Like, I don't know. It's really quick. Sorry. I want to talk about this intro because to me, it's so weird seeing a movie start twice. Like no one does that. And I like want to give a shout out to like the respect that they're giving to the, like by communicating it that way. Like, we're going to start two movies. We're going to start this movie here to, like, give it that weight. Because think about it, how, like, 90%, 99% of the other movies do that. If they're trying to bring up a character that was kind of important in the first one, but not a main character, and now they're trying to bring him up to being like a main character that you care about, how do they make you care about him? Flashbacks. And the flashbacks are normally in some like bah, 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 with to flashback. And it's like, oh, okay,
right.
We've seen that a million times. These guys are like, no, it's its own movie. Start the movie, tell her movie, end it, and start last movie. And like the main movie where both of them are very main characters. It's a very interesting, not dramatic choice, but like artistic choice, I guess. Okay. I don't know. It's just, can you think of another movie that has ever done that? Cause I just off the top of my head, I can't.
So I feel like it poses the question. It lays out the question, very concise, very colorful. But because it's, I don't necessarily see it as two different movies. I feel like it sets the groundwork.
Call them two different movies. I'm using that phrasing to emphasize that they made it seem like it was its own movie. Does that make that more clear? Or did you already understand that? Like,
you know, no, yeah, but I feel like it's an excellent illustration of the hook where it like sets the inciting incident and it hooks you right away. But it's because we're dealing with a multi-universe, multi-dimensional situation, it sets the tone. Okay, this is what's going to be going forward. And now we get into the meat of it. And I feel like when Gwen comes to Miles's house and then they do the whole like hang out upside down and talk, they
which is a good callback to that What's Up Danger scene.
Right. There's definitely like odes back to the first one, but I think at the same time they illustrate, okay, Gwen's having this issue. Now Miles is having this issue. And then they're talking together like, I just wish they could, like as Miles says, we're the same, basically. So it's like we're intertwined together. Yes. So I feel like when you're dealing with dual protagonists, kind of like Game of Thrones, you know how like each chapter is a character and you have all these protagonists going on. In the beginning book of Game of Thrones, you have the whole beginning of these characters, you're like, oh, are these the main characters? They just die, and it creates the problem of the Ice Walkers or whatever. So it's a similar type thing of like, we're going to set this up, now let's get to the action. And I really enjoy narrative that's like that, because it's a quick and very concise way to get skin in the game, I guess. It grabs your attention. You're like, okay, I'm invested. What's going on here? I also really enjoy the aspect of like Miles Morales. When you meet him in the first one, he's listening to hip hop music. His theme is What's Up Danger and Sunflower from Post Malone. So he's like, yeah, I'm this and this. And she's beating on the drums, like very different aspect. Look at it. Yes. And she's like, let's do this again, but a little bit different. And I like the time invested in the development of those two protagonists and the worlds that collide when they come together. So that's why I'm like, I kind of see it as a tone setter. Less of a separate thing, but
I mean, tone setter, separate thing. I guess I think I'm trying to articulate the thing that you just said is that it's like it is two independent worlds colliding. It's not like a supporting character for the main one. Like it, I guess that's what I'm a bit. I still stand by what I was saying. Of it's like I feel like it's them trying to elevate her from a supporting character for Miles to she's her own character. And we're going to now insert that character into this story.
Like, and she's the gateway for the audience. She's leading you by the hand. Yeah. Like, okay, here's the situation in case you don't know.
Yeah. You know, before Miles does, you know,
right now, I know that we're already about 35 minutes in. I'm in about second, third of my cigar here. So I feel like we need to spend some time on second, third, your Crook of the Crown. I don't know if it's changing at all. If you got flavors going on, what are your thoughts?
I'm not going to lie. I don't want to say what I'm tasting or feeling right now, merely because I almost wonder if this one like dried out a little. Because it doesn't feel dry, but as I've been smoking it, the wrapper kind of keeps cracking. And so I'm thinking it might be dry. So it's not, but that's, I mean, I've had it here in my humidor for, you know, quite a while. And my humidor is probably not as nice as many others. So I might be thinking that it's just, it's a little dry. So my flavor notes are pretty light is what I will say.
Okay.
I will say that the flavor notes have been consistent throughout the entire cigar. So it's, but like I said, I think the cigar is a little dry.
Okay. Well, and two, I mean, in terms of like humidity levels, when you're out in Arizona, when it's dry as a desert, yes. typically you're having to push more humidity for certain.
A lot more.
Yeah. And I mean, at least out here in California, where the particular location we're at, I try to stay within like the 67%. I find it's a happy medium. There's like endless debate. There's endless talk about 70-70 when it comes to your humidor. 70%, 70 degrees.
Okay.
That's like the catch-all, like safeguard, I believe a lot of people jump by. And I think it really is subjective to where you live. For me, I found 67% is definitely that better spot. And really, the cigar, sometimes it depends on what you're smoking, at what humidity level it should be. Some cigars require more, some require less. But that tends to be the happy medium for me. In terms of the Anniversario Stallone, which is dropping tomorrow, there's a really good, like, I want to say that peppery note is more cinnamony to me at this point. You get a little more, like, cinnamon sweetness.
Sure.
But that really like espresso is coming through. I want to say perhaps a little bit earthy, but it's more that's an accented flavor. It's not like forward.
Okay.
And yeah, there's almost like when you have like red hot cinnamon, you know how like there's that like sweet spiciness. Yeah. That's kind of what's going on here a little bit. So what I want to kind of talk to and touch on as we're in the second, third, when it comes to cigars, a big thing with the society that we talk about and a big thing also with like certain releases is aging cigars. Mm-hmm. What exactly is the purpose? And I have found, especially this is a good representation. Tony blended this cigar, like I said, about a year and a half ago. And then we were kind of going through blends at that time and I liked it a lot. I found it more kind of like pulling me in opposite directions, like that pepper. And that like espresso was kind of really stark. You get like a little bit of sweetness and then a lot of burn on the retrohale, really forward spice. So when you lay the cigar down for a little bit, those tobaccos are sitting together. They marry together. It kind of like meshes and molds better to like work in transition, smoother transition. So like now we've got that like cinnamon thing going on, that sweetness going on. So us releasing this now with a year and a half of age, I feel is like it's the right time to release it because it's maybe like more balanced in a way.
Okay.
And I think that's the advantage you get from aging cigars. It can work as it doesn't. Yeah.
I also wonder if there's a difference between when like a manufacturer ages the tobacco versus when you age them. Like when you say it's aged a year, is it aged like as a rolled cigar or is it like the tobacco is aged a year and then they roll it?
So in this particular cigar, the filler tobacco has 5 year aged in it. So that tobacco has been fermented, cured and aged in bales for 5 years. Then he rolled it. And after it's been rolled, it has over a year and about almost a year and a half on it. As it is.
Okay. So when people talk about the age, they're talking about after it's a cigar.
Well, yes, for the most part. Yes. They say this is a 1 year age cigar. Yes. Normally it's like prefaced by saying, oh, it's got, I mean, there's a cigar that boasts it's got 18 years of aged tobacco in the filler. So that element. But there's still those tobaccos. When you roll a cigar, you have it rolled, you taste it. Okay, this is great. This is kind of like a glimpse into what is going to be coming for the flavors. When you roll that, that's what's happening. Then a cigar goes through a sick phase. It's like, I believe around like day 35 to like day 45, around in that realm where it's just like, this is, it's been rolled. Now they're trying to mesh and it just is not the time to smoke the cigar. So let it rest and then it'll go out.
Kind of like a good steak. You got to let it rest.
Yeah. So I'm sure you're familiar. A lot of people are familiar with the brand Padron. Mm-hmm. In fact, yes, we've smoked a number of Padrones together.
I was going to say, my only experience in smoking, like, aged cigars, like, for an extended period of time is those Padrones. So.
Okay. So they have, I mean, they're kind of a higher price point. I feel like it's, if you're going to go out and spend a lot of, like, a decent amount of money on a cigar, Padrone's the right one to do it with. But they've got a brand called 1964 and a brand called 1926. Between the two, very similar composition in blend, but the 1964, before it's been released, and this is what I've been told, so I'm going off of information from cigar makers, it's got like 2 or 3 years of age on it. 1926 has 5 years of age, and then they release it. So their whole deal is like, we did the work for you. It's perfect now. Don't really age this cigar. Just smoke it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think there's benefits to aging cigars. Some don't respond so well. When I say this one's got the year and a half, it's actually been in Nicaragua in Tony's aging vault and then was shipped to me and has had an additional 2 months, 2.5 months in the humidor to acclimate. So now it is ready. It's perfect.
Nice.
Yeah.
Jeez, man. I think aging is one of those art things, you know, because I feel like they do it with scotch, right? When they put it into different barrels, they let it sit for a certain number of years. And that's kind of the whole thing, is appreciating the flavor across like the 12-year, the 18-year, you know, whatever it is.
Right.
It's interesting that you can do the same thing with cigars. You know, it's very interesting that this gets better. You know,
yeah, that's part of what me fell in love with it. I'm like, you can actually do this? Really cool. Curtis is commenting, saying this poison dart has a nice toasty quality in the middle, not quite meat flavor, but something like food char. Okay,
interesting. Okay,
and I mean,
I know what he's talking about. Like, it's that like little piece of, you know, charred meat or something, you know, where it's like, it doesn't taste like the meat, but like, yeah, it's that kind
it's of like burnt ends almost.
Yeah.
Barbecue.
But they're good. Like, I don't know. I always feel like those are the parts you kind of go for.
Yeah. 100%. Yeah. So, yeah, if you guys have an aged cigar, I would definitely say try it. It's kind of the focal point of the society. That's why you get a 5-pack.
I was going to say, that's the whole point of the society, is you have 5 cigars so you can kind of age them and enjoy them at different points.
Right. We released the cigar last year called the Tyler Durden. It was a 5.5x52 Robusto closed foot. And it's got some punch. It's got some strength to it. To this day, it's one of my favorite cigars that we have aged through the society. Like, it's got like this sweet caramel, this vegetable thing going on. It's really good. Really good.
That's awesome.
So, but yeah, so that is the second, third, getting back to the movie. I know we're already like 43 minutes in. Where would you say the attack is when, like, we first see these the major dramatic question? Well, not major. When we see protagonist and antagonist meet, what would you say is like one of the pivotal moments?
Where the protagonist and... Well, let's... Oh, okay. Hold the phone here. Before we put me on the spot like this, I'm already sweating. You can see me shining. Who's the antagonist of this movie? Or what is the antagonist of this movie? Either or.
That's actually a really good question. I think part of the problem solving, and Curtis or anyone else, please chime in this and your thoughts on the antagonist. Here's another one. Like, this might be a hot take, but this is what my thought is.
Take a hot take. Yeah. Let's hear it.
If we're talking about dual protagonists and having this issue of feeling like belonging and home, I feel like part of it is having to take that kind of leap and trust in the people that you love and the place that you're at. Even when it doesn't seem maybe traditional or it's that much more risky. And so like how much do you really trust these people, or how much do you really trust? Like, do you trust with your identity, with really who you really are, with the people that you know, like how well you know them? And so I personally feel like the antagonist is like when she like sneaks off and is like rewatching what the spot did. And she's like, oh crap, I gotta fix this. And Miles goes to the apartment too. And he's like watching invisible. And he like, is like, okay, I'm gonna have to do this again, do this too, go with her. Like, he's also putting this like, okay, they know that they belong together. They're dealing with a similar situation. He's putting a lot of trust in her, of like, this is who I am. And I've got to just show you and you'll see what I'm talking about. Type of thing. And she's like, okay, I'll never see him again, but I can fix this. I can take responsibility in spite of what other people are saying. That's kind of loosely what I'm thinking. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, the reason why I'm asking is because, to be honest, this is one of those movies like I haven't like fully broken down yet. Like I'm still munching on all these different like really impactful scenes or like topics that they're trying to tackle, and so that's what I'm still trying to process through that. I almost feel like though, when you're setting up your kind of dual protagonists and what are they both dealing with? Like they're both kind of dealing with belonging, expectations, and all that type of, you know, I feel like this is one of those movies that it's like as a teenager, this is one of those movies that probably helps you to feel like seen, you know, just like, oh my gosh. Yeah. I don't feel like people are listening to me. I don't feel like, you know, anything like that. So it's like, I feel like there's that whole, like, I mean, think about her whole introduction and what does she keep repeating throughout it? It's like, he's not the only one. He's not the only one. He's not the only one. Like, she's trying to kind of include herself. Okay. And I don't know. It's like, but then once we actually get into, like, the Spider-Verse and Miles is able to kind of get in there or whatever, we find out that Miles is the problem. She almost kind of rejoins the supporting cast of, like, oh, yeah, we're kind of here to, like, fix you in a way, like you're not supposed to be here. Okay. Because I feel like that's like the big kind of dynamic that's happening is Miles, it's you're shown throughout his story that it's like his parents are there.
Yeah.
It's like he has a friend who's like, he even jokes, he's like, this is a slippery slope, like I'm not going to become your guy in the chair. Like he's already got a network of people. And it's like, and then what is happening with her? It's like They literally say it. They're like, she's dealing with this on her own. So it's one of those things where it's like the narrative of Spider-Man is he's alone. And then you get Miles and you're shown that he's not alone. But it's also like, what does Spider-Man 2099 say? You know, good old Oscar Isaac. It's like, you don't belong. Like, you're not meant to be here type thing. Like, you're in the wrong place. And they even, I feel, I can't remember the exact line, but I feel like there was even a point where they kind of pointed at it, where it's like, your canon event is coming up of like him losing his dad. And he's like, no, I can fix this. Like, you know, let me go. You know, and they're like, no, the canon event is coming. But yet he doesn't belong. So it's almost like they're trying to fast track him to tragedy so that he can beat Spider-Man. And he's kind of like, no. So it's, that's why it's like hard. Because I agree with the dual protagonist. I'm the one who suggested it because I believed it. But it's weird how they like still shift it and show that she's actually more a part of like Spider-Verse than he is to kind of like re-isolate them. Because I feel like they spent a whole huge part of the movie trying to make them on the same plane and the same kind of thing. But then they re-isolate him back out. And they, and I'm trying to remember, they don't really like fix that or address that, right? Like, that's probably what the third one's going to be about.
I mean, partly. I'm actually curious too. Here's Curtis.
Sorry. Okay. Sorry.
Well, no. I think it's possible to argue that the antagonist is freedom and fan expectations, and how they turn angry when you don't meet their expectations. McGill represents this because the Spot isn't really the villain. I agree. I know.
We haven't even talked about the Spot. I love it.
Which I feel like he's a good representation of the problem, but he's not the problem. Like he's kind of the catalyst for the issue.
Of course.
And it's true. I love how they point out like Miles is joking with the Spot, saying of like, oh, he's just a run of the mill villain.
Yeah, villain of the week.
Yeah. And how he's just like, no, I'm not. And it's like, well, it's true. When you
yeah, I'm your arch nemesis. Or
when you grow up reading Spider-Man stuff, you're just like, who made this guy? Like, what? Right. Why is he a problem? I don't understand. So, I mean, I think that's well represented in that for sure. But I mean, I think too, those expectations, I agree with. There's expectations on Gwen for like when she's like, oh no, this couldn't have happened, and Drew on the bike like says, hey, what's going on here? And so she's like, no, I can fix this. Like she's like proving to them I can fix this, and Miles is proving to her, no, I can do this too, I'm Spider-Man, just trust me. So they're just like, I want to live up to this expectation, and they're both having to struggle with that. We got Sev jumping on. Sev, how you doing? Good to see you.
Hi. Yeah, well, and I also feel like there's there's the whole scene, because we already touched on it earlier, but there's the whole scene. Okay, sorry. Pause really quick. I'm going to talk about the scene where they're sitting upside down. But pause for a second and just, I know we kind of mentioned the visual, like, just when you think of this movie, you just think of the visuals. So much of this movie is told in how they choose to frame things, how they color them, how they cut between things.
Yes. Yes.
How, like, oh, just, oh my gosh. It's, this is it, like, it's on the level of Mad Max in the sense of, like, you have to watch this movie.
Right.
Like, this is not a movie you can, yes, you, like, you don't listen to this movie, you watch it and you experience it. Like, half the time, you are you even really registering what they're saying, or are you just, like, internalizing everything because of the images and colors you're seeing? Like, I don't know. It's just
watch it twice with different pairs of eyes when you watch
it. Yes. Oh, exactly. But so, really quick, talking about Miles and her and their kind of relationship, and she can do this, he can do this. There's also the scene where they're both sitting. And it's they frame it where she is upright and then she walks upside down. She shoots her webs and then pulls herself to a sitting position, sitting upside down. And it pans out to him standing right side up. And it's just like those types of things where it's like she's upside down, like she doesn't know. And he's standing upright, you know, kind of showing that. And then he comes down, comes around, comes upside down and sits next to her. And then they start talking. Like, there's so many of those types of visuals that you're just like, geez.
And,
but
and
that whole conversation, sorry, really quick. Just I'm hitting side points while I'm trying to get to my main point. The main point is the, when they're sitting there talking about it, there's, I don't know. There's this way of them trying, because she talks about, like, in every other universe, Gwen falls for Spider-Man.
Right.
In every other universe, it doesn't end well for her, you know? And it's like, there's that calling back to that expectations of, it's like, this story has been told before. And what is Miles's response? If it's like, well, you know, there's a first time for everything. And I feel like that's also just like a major, just poof of like, Miles is there to be the first time for everything. Like, he's like, he is there to kind of break that mold.
Right.
And so I don't know. I almost feel like, is that the major dramatic question of just like,
I think
are you a victim of your story, or like, are you able to just break the mold? You know, I don't know.
Okay. Oh. So something to tackle that real quick. Sev's asking, about the new Spider-Man movie. Yes, we are.
Across the Spider-Verse.
Yeah, let me know your thoughts on it. Also, let me know what you're smoking. Love to pull it up. But I will also say, I feel like maybe we talked about in a convoluted way. That is the amount of expectation, because when you go, I feel like this movie, it's major dramatic question of those expectations and do you belong and such like that. And the representation of these characters in this, like, again, I love how they use the canon, because we were watching a story based on a canon. Yeah. When you're dealing with all these things, just like a second to a first movie, the expectation the audience has on the movie. And so it's also playing that, like, that dual side of, like, this is what the movie's about, but also we're telling you this to the audience who has these expectations. I know who Spider-Man is. I've watched these movies. I know all these things that are going to happen. It's like, like, for most people, like, when she says that line, in every other multiverse, Gwen falls for Spider-Man, it's like, we know what she's going to say before she says it. Miles doesn't. And so that expectation through line follows them through every multiverse that they go through. So I do think that Curtis probably put it in a, said it in a far better concise way of that expectation, but I feel like that's what you're dealing with. And even Spot has expectations of, you're the lame supervillain. Like, that's who you are. That's who you embody. And it's like, no, he's...
And he breaks that mold. Yeah.
So what I want to kind of do is, let's shoot forward to, they go to leagues of different, like, multiverses. I want to on that visual aspect you were telling me about, talking about. One in particular is the biggest and most, like, dramatic for me are the conversations between Gwen's dad and herself, and how the color changes happen, how the how the shapes happen. Because when you watch a comic book, when you read a comic book, like, you're reading the script, but the visual is to aid and tell you the emotion behind it. And
Exactly.
I would be hard pressed to find a well, not A, but movies that do a similar type of thing. It's kind of few and far between, unfortunately.
Well, and it's one of those where it is obvious enough to make the impact, but it's also not like beating you over the head with it. You know, like it's done in a very strong, subtle way. Mm-hmm. But watching that whole opening sequence of Gwen and her dad and that whole scene of blue, red, or, you know, kind of blue, warm, and then how it calls back to it on the second conversation. Right. And just like, it's intense, you know, like just the emotion that you feel as these colors are shifting through the story. Like, it's just, oh, it's great. But I think that's kind of, I don't know. It's
so I think here's something I want to touch on in that. Really quick, let's see. Sev's saying, I'm smoking a Trinidad Espiritu Serie 2. Very nice. Very nice. Smoking the new Stallone and a Vesario that drops tomorrow. Brilliant cigar. And actually a question I have later that I want you to mull over before we get to the final third. This is I got to attribute this to Curtis. He was like, maybe you should ask this question. And I think it's a good one. When we get to the final question of the cigar, once you've gone through the journey of the cigar, what if that cigar was a movie? What movie would that cigar be?
Oh, gosh.
So it's going to take a while. You got to get the feeling. Yeah. You know the tone. But with that stated, so we go to different worlds and dimensions. One of the major ones we spend time in is the 2099 universe. This like very boxy industrial grays and like blinking reds and such like this. I feel like if we see the representation of this like extreme color palette of Gwen Stacy's and how it's ever changing the mood, and then you see Miles, which is more classic, it's got the texture dot and it's more like digestible, and then you get to his world. Each world represents the characters pretty well. So this mistrust through line of Miguel's character, Oscar Isaac, is well represented in the world that he lives. It's very rigid. It's very sharp-edged. And it's funny because even the places that Miguel lives and goes, so many of the others that are a part of this spider squad or whatever are not even admitted to those areas.
Right. Yeah.
So, and two, I'm trying to remember, oh my gosh, I can't believe I'm blanking on this. Spider-Punk, though. That's how I know him from the comic books.
Hobie?
Yeah.
Oh, Hobie?
Yeah, Hobie.
Hobie? Isn't it Hobie? Or is it Hobie?
Maybe it's Hobie.
Maybe it's Hobie? Hobie, Hobie? I don't know. I think it's Hobie, isn't it?
Like I said, I've always known him as Spider-Punk. But, awesome visual. Like,
yes. It's
great.
Yeah.
It's great.
Yeah. No, and that's what I mean is the depths that they're able to go to with all the different Spider-Men or Spider-Women or Spider-People, whatever, it's so much fun because it's able to show that it's like you can have different versions of Spider-Man. You know, like, I don't know. It's one of those things that it's a very nice visual representation, and they each bring something different to the table. Like, I don't know. Like I said, they really did. But I do agree with you that in 2099, it's harsh color tones. There's not mixing, you know, of palettes. There's not, all the edges are very sharp and harsh. Mm-hmm. It's like, because Miguel's very black and white. He's not in, you know, in Gwen's, you see the melding of colors and then the separation of colors. And then in Miles, you just have, it's like normal, you know.
It's like normal. Classic.
It's like classic, you know.
Yeah.
And that, that's what I mean. It's hard to put into words what you're like visualizing or seeing. Like, oh gosh.
Right.
Well, and that's what I love that they did it. Like, it's so amazing.
Yeah. And I think that they're using the art. The art is a character in this movie telling it. So I think it's a good way of like, okay, so you have all these spider people. At this one location, and you have people like Hobie that is like allowed in the like inner sanctum area and stuff, but like clearly he does not belong in this world. And there's questions like, okay, do I belong? And like trying to find that, which I find really like interesting. And you see too, like when you see Miguel's figure as Spider-Man 2099. I noticed he's one of the few spider people where his edges are blurred, like on his shoulders, like everything is just blurred around, which I think is a good too representation of like his moral edge line is it's a little blurry, like his, yeah, his like actual moral construct, because mm-hmm. of it, his whole focus is the canon and you can't break canon no matter who it kills, basically for the greater good.
Right. Well, because he believes what he's doing is correct.
Right.
You know, it doesn't matter. Because, I mean, there's that whole scene. I don't know. Is that maybe is that the climax or maybe that's the major dramatic question? Is that it's like, what does Miles do? He breaks the canon in his universe because a spider went there, bit him, and he became Spider-Man and he wasn't supposed to. And yeah. then what does he do in this other universe when they're with the Indian Spider-Man where he saves people when it was a canon event mm-hmm. and he wasn't supposed to. And he's like, I saved those people. And they're like, yeah, you weren't supposed to. This was his canon event. You screwed it up. And it's like this kind of callback to like, he keeps screwing things up and he's like, but I can fix this. I can fix this. And I mean, and isn't that kind of like a comparison to the other three spider people where it's like when they first recruit Gwen, what does she say? She's like, I don't know how to fix this. And he's like, uh-huh. join the club, you know, like yeah. welcome to the camp. We don't know how to fix it. And it's yeah. just kind of interesting where they don't know how to fix it, but they're trying to fix it versus Miles has this attitude of like, I can fix it and I will. Like, mm-hmm. I don't know. It's an interesting play on it.
Right. That scene when he's confronted with all that and like, this is the canon, you keep the canon intact and you, even though we're able to jump through multiverses, you don't ever destroy that canon, regardless of who it's going to kill. So just to let you know, your dad's going to die. Like
right.
that sequence, I feel is that approach to the innermost cave, dark moment, like, okay, here's the mm-hmm. crux of the matter. And then him choosing like, no, I'm going to fight against it is the crisis. Okay. So now he's got the idea. Now he knows what he needs to do. The action is now shifting from confusion and let me live up to this expectation to this expectation right here. I know what's being pushed on me. I cannot, I've learned what I need to actually combat it. And I feel like that's where we get to kind of the crisis of the film. Like on the when it's going, the train is going upward and he's fighting all the spider people to stop it. Like, I feel like that's right. where we see the action change happen.
Okay.
For me personally, I don't know. It sounds like you're unconvinced.
To be perfectly frank, I need to watch it again. Like that's... I want to, because that's the hard part is so as I'm talking about this, I'm contradicting myself. I started to say, it's there's, and as I'm talking about, I'm like, oh, maybe I don't agree with that anymore. You know, because like I'm seeing the new narratives or new stories or, you know, like the different connection points. It's what I mean is like these types of movies, they're so much fun because they're just, there's so much in there.
So let's take Gwen Stacy's journey. And her like right. watching him do this, and she's like, you know what, he's right, and it clicks. And then, I mean, it's always like you don't tell, especially in like Ultimate Spider-Man, such you don't tell your loved ones who you are and that you're Spider-Man, such. And she goes back to actually deal with the issue with her dad, and be mm-hmm. like, I have to embrace this. I can't just like walk away from it like I did. And I feel yeah. both of them have those moments of like, okay, regardless, they're now going to go against the canon. They're going to go against this problem to fix the issue.
Right.
So that's why I lean towards that kind of like plot point.
Which, maybe this is going too meta in the conversation, but isn't that like, in a weird way, what we're dealing with now, in the age of technology and information sharing, we are able to get information so quickly or find, you know, some sort of, I don't know, tutorial information, whatever, on whatever you want to do, whatever you want to learn, whatever, like information is out there ready to go for you.
Okay.
So it almost feels like, or just in terms of diagnostics for your car, for your family, for your health, like whatever, there's always like these guides, the right way to do things. Like it almost feels like everything has already been done and it's been documented so well. And now that it's like, you don't have to go to the Library of Alexandria to, you know, find out what if someone mm-hmm. did 500 years ago, it's yeah. like every single one of us can find it out in about 30 seconds if you know how to search the right thing.
Right.
It's one of those things where it's like, I could see where that is a very overwhelming feeling of, everything has been lived or everything has been done. So my path is already out, like laid out before me. And it's like these two characters, what do they choose to do? They say, screw it, I'm going to do something different. Like, it's not. I don't know. Like I said, maybe that's a little too meta, but it's...
I could see that. I could see that.
It's an interesting thing that's unique to this time.
Right. And it's... Unfortunately, it doesn't always go well, but that doesn't mean you don't try. No.
Exactly. Like, exactly.
That's
the whole thing, right? It's like, I don't care that this has been done in millions, billions of Spider-Verses. I'm still going to try. I don't care that Gwen every time, you know, it doesn't end well. I'm going to try.
Right.
Doesn't matter if my dad is supposed to die that can it. I don't care. I'm going to try. Like, I'm Spider-Man. This is what I do. Mm-hmm. So it's just kind of like, instead of succumbing to what you think is your fate, it's like, no, I'm going to fight against it. Like, screw that.
Right.
I don't know. That's right. It's such a simple and classic like message, but it's, I don't know. They found a new way to tell that story that applies to now, you know, I don't know. It's good.
Yeah.
What movies are supposed to do.
Well, and it also, I think it represents really well on that sequel classic, like, if I think of a trilogy where the second was better than the first, and I'm not saying this one is the same. I'm not saying it's better than the first one. But yeah, Empire Strikes Back. I like the transition from, I think this is a better movie than A New Hope. I also know that it ends on such a big downer.
Yeah.
And likewise with Across the Spider-Verse, you have a kind of a similar through line.
Exactly.
Where you get to that climactic moment of like, okay, so he's raised an army and he's actually like, through his example, there are other people out there. It's like, no, he's doing the right thing, even if it's against the canon. But it doesn't end well for him. And I will just say, this movie, I think, was one of the most pleasantly unexpected endings. I really didn't see that happening, coming at all.
Which really?
Good. Like, I didn't think it was just going to be like, okay, to be continued.
Just
I was like,
in cliffhanger? Oh, yeah. I see what you're saying. And I agree. Yeah. When the movie ended, I was like, hold the phone.
Right.
Why is it over? Like, we're not even close to being done.
Well, and I think that is a really good way to treat the plot with justice when it comes to Spider-Man canon. Because he's fighting all these things. He's trying to like fix it while like kicking against the goad of like, this is how things happen. And it even like ends on him, like how it happens. To be continued is one of the oldest things within comic books. It was always like that. Here's the next hook. So we make sure you get your next issue.
Yeah. You gotta buy the next one.
Yeah. The only difference is you have the advantage of like, when you're reading through physical pages, you're like, oh, there's only two more pages. What's going to happen?
You know.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, overall, I would say that like, I appreciate this movie for its direction. I appreciate it even more for its visual. It's not one of those Pirates of the Caribbean, hey, you made one movie, we need to pump out five others, but we put it all in one movie. Sorry. Like, we got to have more. So,
that, truth be told, that was like my biggest fear for this movie, is that it, because when you watch Into the Spider-Verse, you feel like that's a package deal. Like, they put it all in there, they got it done, and they wrapped it up with the little, you know, voiceover of Spider-Man swinging through the city of, you know, telling us that everything's going to be okay and he's the new Spider-Man, you know?
Right.
You're like, gosh, that was a good movie. And then it's like Spider-Man 2 or Across the Spider-Verse. You're just kind of like, I hope they didn't burn all their material in the first one. You know, like, I really hope they held some back. And then you watch the second one, you're like, holy crap, I think they might have actually planned this out as a trilogy. Made it really like, we're going to make, you know, because you think about A New Hope ends very well. Like, they,
right.
I feel like they're copying that original Star Wars trilogy very, very well. Like, they're doing
as long
it
as it's not like, the end, like Miguel beat by, beat by a bunch of like furry spider, like bugs or teddy bears. Yeah. We got a question here saying from Curtis Bailey. Question: did you guys know this was a part one, and did that or did it not impact how the movie and its ending played for you? Because it did for me.
I did not know it was like a part one of two parts. Like, if that makes sense. No, I thought it was going to be another like, this is the second, you know, Spider-Man. I didn't know that it was like part one, part two. I did not know that.
Now, the question I would say back to you, Curtis, is how did that affect this movie for you? In like what way was that impactful? For me, I did not know either. And it actually, it was like an upswing of admiration for the movie, because I was like, that well handled, like a very well kept secret. I didn't know that was coming. And at the same time, like,
we might all be searching hard anymore. You know, like,
were you what?
Following every art? I'm saying we might not be following all the articles and all the other things where people say it's like, oh, this is part one of part two. You know, like, it's, I don't know, it's, or part one of two. You know, it's, yeah. I don't know. Because I don't research movies anymore. Like, if I see a trailer, I'm like, oh, I might see that one. You know,
right. No, I was pleasantly surprised with it. I thought it was really cool, and I was like, they're keeping with the it handles the tongue in cheek and self awareness of like, yeah, Spider-Man's a kid's movie, but this doesn't mean it has to be just for kids or just for teenagers. But it also pays respect to the formula of like classic Spider-Man story, so it's not just like, we're bringing this new character in and he's, you know, he's a young hip teenager that does teenager things, and it's updated to like touch a generation. It's well handled. Curtis is saying, for me, not knowing was a part one made me question the film's structure and how/where it spent its time, like how the spot disappears for a huge chunk of it. Okay. So
yeah, I mean, yeah, go ahead.
I was going to say, so like maybe it could have been more, I don't know, economical potentially. I'm
assuming he probably is saying that it probably felt like weirdly paced in certain areas. Like, why aren't we moving faster? Because I mean, I'll say with the whole, you have Gwen's story for like 20 minutes and then you kind of restart the movie and then go through whole like Miles introduction again. I will say it felt like a little like, this feels like a lot of introduction. Like, sure, we're halfway through the movie. Like, how are we going to wrap this thing up? I definitely thought or felt that. But I'll say once kind of the action kicked up and the tension kicked up, like, it felt like it was going to conclude well. And then that's why, like, yeah, when the movie's like, all right, movie's done. You know, it's like.
So this is what I will say. I think that the structure works for me because, once again, running that parallel analogy with like comic books, there are so many comic books out there that probably it's like a 5-part series, could have been a 3-part series, but I really enjoyed and geeked out at the double art spread of like, you got a 2-page spread just to show one visual and a few captions internally and like the credits of who created this comic book. So I feel like those moments of that like awesome art happens in those introductions, or it happens when like Gwen and he are like swinging through the city. Like, so I don't have an issue with it. Curtis saying, if I had known it was only intended to be half a story, then those questions in my head would have disappeared. Instead, they bugged me the whole time. Okay.
The visual represent, as I read that, the visual represent, I can hear Curtis saying it right now. Like, I know exactly how he said that. And it's not a bad thing. It's more just like, I know exactly what he means. That it's like, there are those like frustrating things that can happen where you're like, I wouldn't have been distracted by this whole time. Like, I could have focused on other things and appreciated it. Like, you feel like almost cheated. Yeah. No, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's slightly different for him, but I know what he means.
Okay.
I can't say that I ever felt cheated in this movie, or not cheated, but like I wasn't distracted by it. I was able to kind of get re-sucked in or reinvigorated into the story, just because, like I said, I mean, I feel like visually you're so bombarded that like you have to keep up. You know, like, I don't know, my mind wasn't able to wander just based on the different visuals, the different art styles and all that stuff.
Right.
You know, because like, yeah, no, I would agree. My brain is trying to go like, wait, how is that art in this? What's going on here? It's like, you're trying to interpret what's being communicated with the art. Because to be perfectly frank, some of those sequences happen so fast, it's hard to keep up, you know, with the different styles.
But. So overall, like, I think that it definitely creates more expectation in the trilogy.
I know.
I feel like it's I don't have many complaints about it. I mean, it's a long movie. If I'm doing the comparison, like which one do I enjoy more? Because that's where my sure. brain always goes. That's how I always think. I think as a story and as a concept, I think I would side with the first one. If I want to watch for rewatch value, I probably would watch the second one. Like rewatch value for the second one, like visually is just so there for me that I'm like, I love the exploration of different style and different multiverse. So yeah, in terms of the movie, like rating out of 10, I think for me personally, I'm going to give this one like a 7.5.
Wow. Overall. Okay. Yeah.
Like,
I mean,
maybe
I would
7.8,
definitely...
but yeah.
Jeez. I'd give this movie a solid 9. Like it's a super solid movie. I mean, there's weak parts. It's not a 10. But it's, for me at least, like I said, I think just the wow factor watching, and maybe that's like kind of the whole blessing and curse of being ignorant, that you really do just get to get hit with that, you know, big ass baseball bat, you know, and you're not even expecting it. It just catches you completely off guard. Versus if you've like researched it and prepared yourself and you're expecting this thing to be amazing, and then you're disappointed because you built it up way bigger in your head. Like, I think I probably benefited a lot from not building this up at all. Like, I was telling myself, I'm like, I have no hopes for this thing. It's going to be bad because I know it's not going to be as good as the first. And I think that's why it just caught me so off guard, because I'm like, holy dang. They they went for it and they did it. You know, they didn't try and beat the first one. They just kept plowing forward. And in my opinion, like I said, they beat the first one, like, just in my opinion. Rewatch value in terms of like standalone, just kind of watch it one and done. Number one is always going to be like number one. Like, it's just, it's kind of like New Hope. Like, it's one of those things where it's like, when you think about Star Wars movies, and I think back to how many Star Wars movies I've watched, New Hope probably is the highest amount of like rewatch. Okay. But I would never say that that one's my favorite or that it's the best one, but I've seen it the most. And I feel like that's probably what Into the Spider-Verse is going to be for me, where it's like, I've seen it the most and it's an amazing movie and people need to like pay attention to like what they did at a like a conceptual level. But, and try and, you know, reiterate on it again. But I feel like the second one is one of those movies where you're just like, this is just a really good movie. Like, it's just really good.
Okay, well, yeah, and Curtis, curious to see what your rating 1 to 10 would be for this. As you said, I think my impression of the movie will drastically change on a second viewing. Sure,
and then I'm going to admit I tried to give it a second watch through, and I only got like halfway through. Okay. So I'm like, I really want to rewatch that second half again because there's so much that happens there. You know that, that's what I mean. I'm alone, but I just. There are certain movies that make me want to watch them multiple times just to kind of
pick at the
different things. This is one of those movies where I want to watch it multiple times. Like as you were saying, the rewatch value is very much there on this movie.
Sure. Yeah. Now in terms of the cigar, I'm like down to nubbing this Anniversario.
Yeah.
It's a really good cigar. In terms of like, 1 to 10, I'm going to say that this one for me is probably a 9 out of 10. It hits a lot of elements that I really enjoy. It has a maturity level that I feel sometimes when you're dealing with heavier cigars, you kind of just have that brash, like it's going to throw your palate around. It's going to give it a few punches. You really enjoy it, but it's kind of more just like power forward. Whereas this, I feel like while it's stronger in this last third, the spice has ramped up. That like there's like a dusty like element to it, more like leathery, I would say. Espresso and sweetness has kind of died off a little bit. It feels definitely darker and heavier. But yeah, it's definitely a 9 out of 10 in terms of what movie I think that this would be well represented. Like if I was going to sit this down, watch this movie, and these two things are synergizing very well, I would say that this is a There Will Be Blood type of movie for me.
Oh, okay.
It's got some impactful, heavy moments to the cigar. It's also got a lot of nuance and complexity to it. And it also kind of just like, your palate wakes up with it. And so like the dramatic scenes of There Will Be Blood, there's some parallels. Like I need to smoke this with that movie.
Okay. Okay.
Thoughts on Crook of the Crown?
Once again, I'm not saying my review is worth anything just because, like I said, I think this cigar is a little dried because the heat and the heat pepper really kicked up in this final third.
Okay.
It's that still
does sound dry. Yeah.
Yeah. The one thing I will say about it, though, is even though it's dry, I've been smoking it this whole time. Like I haven't wanted to put it down.
Okay.
And because it has been burning kind of hot, I got to say, this one for me is like Fast and Furious, where it's like I can't stop watching it and it's kind of hot, you know, but it's I don't know if it's good.
Okay. I would definitely
say that about the cigar as a whole. I'm just saying
right.
My specific one.
I think it needs a rewatch for sure.
Yes, exactly. I don't know if Fast and Furious does, but
yeah. Okay, so Curtis is saying in terms of the movie, 7. Loses points for weird structure and surprise ending. Gains points for visual creativity, thematic depth, and Hobie. Well, there you go.
Everyone loves Hobie.
And we also Steve. Steve saying hello.
Steve! Hey! How's it going, Steve?
Mallory's also giving thumbs up on Hobie.
Yeah?
That character as well.
Who was?
Mallory was.
Mallory was. Yeah. I want to say, I feel like I saw or read something that said that like Hobie was the character of this movie that everyone got super excited for when he was in it.
Yeah, for sure.
Now, so here I'm going to defer to your comic book knowledge. Spider-Punk, like how successful of a storyline is that?
I only knew of him through like pictures, cover art. I didn't really ever explore, like I remember looking through his comic book. And so when they chose to go with the visual representation, I was like, wow, that's awesome. Like it's pretty spot on. But in terms of like the depth of story about him and stuff, I
gotcha. Okay.
Don't really know. So,
yeah.
But yeah, so that is Across the Spider-Verse in a snapshot.
Yeah.
For any of those listening or watching, this cigar, the one I just smoked, Anniversario by Stallone Cigars, drops tomorrow. That would be Thursday, August 17th, 9:00 Pacific Standard Time, which translates to midnight Eastern Standard. I highly encourage you guys to check this cigar out. It is definitely on my top list for this year. Absolutely love it. And I also got to get some out to you, Coleman, so you can try some as well. Because very good. But thank you guys for spending the time and hanging out with us on Cigars and Cinema. Yeah. And make certain that you guys going forward, we will be live 7:30 Pacific Standard on Tuesdays forward. So grab a cigar. We'll go ahead and start promoting like what we're going to be talking about as well as what we're going to be smoking. So you can smoke with us here on the channel.
Exactly.
But yeah, thank you guys for hanging out with us. And we'll see you guys on Tuesday.
Yeah, we'll see you guys later.